My name is Florence To, and I work as an artist director in special design practices, and I will give a workshop today on subaltern relationships in fantasy and materiality. This is a brief overview of my work. I work with different spaces, spaces involving sound and light installations, audiovisual performances. I also worked with building instruments and previously had done residencies in neuroscience and photonics. In this workshop, I will give a brief outlook on my history, as I will give you some tasks on how to go through the histories of your practice, but also deeper histories that link to the land you relate to, but also questioning one world systems and identities we all have been put in this world. As Anglo-European societies awakened from the slow unraveling in one world systems, after privileged identities cultivated conscious refusal and ignorance by the ideological conditions of political, social, and cultural apparatus, how do artists, designers respond with their current practice? A design-driven practice is not without theory, cultivating continuous and fluid response to the changing present. How do we generate ideas without creating borders in language to not identify human behavior with one reality but as multiple? And how do we question the epistemologies of our current role? And where is the route to ignite these discussions? In this workshop, I will go through the theoretical process in various modalities within embodied spaces, addressing the ideologies through the visual aesthetics in my work, which can add a new perspective in relation to the one world systems that are in place. I will not go into too much detail, but enough to give understanding on the perspective of my heritage. Actions do not spring from judgment and reasoning, but from an immediate coping with what is confronting us. We can only say we do such things because the situation brought forth the action from us. The implication for knowledge of the inevitable immersion is that we find a via media to understand the regularity of the world we're experiencing at every moment, but without any reference point dependent of ourselves. We have only the world that we bring forth with others, and only love helps us bring it forth. So in the first exercise, and I will use my world, my roots as an example, I want you to describe your relationship to the present land you're living in, where your native roots, your grandparents, parents, and also create a dialogue of your lineage from your roots to your practice. It could be in any form of an image, collage, or words. As storytelling is an effective way in relating stories to the present. Even if there are perspectives from different angles, it doesn't mean it's less real. We all relate to emotions in multiple ways, but it's our openness in learning and making the eyes wider that we allow us to investigate in multiple perspectives and have some agency produced through our personal stories. I was born in Scotland. My relationship to this land was not existing, especially in the 80s and 90s, where ethnic diversity in my residing area was still at the beginning of its growth. My parents migrated from Hong Kong in the 70s. My mother lived in Birmingham and then moved to Scotland where she met my father. I am a native Hong Konger with origins from mainland China. My mother's parents were rooted in Canton, then situated in Hong Kong after being exiled from mainland China. My first language is English, but I had inherited the knowledge of Cantonese from my parents. My parents' ethnic group is Han, and my father is Hakka, my mother's Han. From 1937 to 1949 in Canton, mainland China, my grandmother had her own textiles export business, and my grandfather worked as a secret policeman for the leader of the Kuomintang, also known as the Chinese Nationalist Party, who fought against the Chinese Communist Party. He fought in the war of resistance against Japan aggression, which is also considered as the Second Sino-Japanese War and World War II. And he was bodyguard for the KMT leader, Chiang Kai-shek. The land reform movement was a campaign by the CCP leader, Mao Zedong, during the end of the Civil War. It involved the mass murder of landlords by tenants and land redistribution to the peasantry. 2 to 3 million were killed and were targeted at the basis of their social class rather than ethnicity. It was a class-motivated murder continuing almost throughout 30 years of social and economic transformation in Mao's China. And by the end of the reforms, most of the citizens had been largely eliminated from mainland China or had fled to Taiwan. Just as Hong Kong was given back to Britain after the Japanese surrendered on August 1945, my grandfather fled to Hong Kong as his wife had no means of transportation. There were no more places in the train. He had got on the last train that was running before everything was shut down. And just one day before, I had all his assets taken away from him. My grandmother jumped into the river and swam through the border of Hong Kong. They settled in Fanling in the new territories and restarted their life as farmers. And here's a picture of what was life like for farmers in Hong Kong with all the post-war refugees. Up until the 1960s, farming provided a means of livelihood for the majority of indigenous habitats, as well as the thousands of mainland Chinese refugees who settled in new territories as rice, vegetable and livestock farmers in the aftermath of World War II and the Chinese Civil War. After the wars, subsistence agriculture was actively promoted by the colonial government and agricultural aid to alleviate poverty and create social stability. Hong Kong farmers' identities closely resembled Chinese farmers before the mid-20th century, in that they were primarily led to agricultural work and the household without the class referred to as peasant. Many traditional Chinese customs had begun to fade away in urban Hong Kong and in mainland China, especially after the Communist Revolution of 1949. Peasant practices were preserved in rural new territories well into the 1970s. In China, Nongmen is an expression of social and political importance. Since the establishment of the People's Republic of China in 1949, the term peasant Nongmen not only refers to people whose livelihoods depend on agriculture, but is also incorporated in China's administrative classification, along with other status groups such as workers and urban residents. Peasantry is an indispensable part of political discourse and economic development in the PRC. They remain one of the most socially marginalized groups in China today. And here's a map of the new territories in Hong Kong, and these are the villages that were developed during the Mao period, the post-Mao period, for people to escape the elimination of class systems and to find a new life, where most of them became farmers. And these are pictures that I took of my family heritage 6 years ago, apart from this picture of me with my grandmother and the house they built. And this is the border, Shanshun River, which is also called Shenzhen River, which a lot of people had fled China to get to Hong Kong, who swam through this river. And this is the village that she grew up in Zhancheng District. This village has not adapted that much. It's kind of stayed true to its nature since the 30s, or maybe before that. And these are my relatives who continue to live in this area. And also in the villages back then, they all had their own crops. So each resident were designated crops in this particular land. And this is my grandfather. Who built at the time they called them squatter huts. Apart from that, it was their hut for their family, and as they had multiple children, every time they had a child, they built a wall up, which would fit just a bed. And again, they remained in the field of farming. My family, my mum, she also grew up looking after pigs, collecting water pails in the morning, and my uncle still lives there today. And this is the letter area where they pick up their letters. And this is the journey through towards their home, where you can see the mountains. Few of any of these outsiders settled in the original village of Kwantai, which is where my family settled. Instead, a cluster of settlements extended along the periphery and became known as Kwantai North Village. Refugee settlers came in waves and eventually formed in time residential niches based on place of origin. The big enclaves in Kwantai North were made up of people from Dongguan and Shunde in Guangdong province. Even in the process of expansion, the original habitats were unable to keep track of the actual tenants cultivating the land. Most built squatter huts in the fields, and because landlord-tenant relationships were not close, sometimes tenants changed hands without the landlord's knowledge. Kwantai was also the site of large vegetable cooperative and home to several pig and poultry farms. And anyone interested, this information was taken from this book by Alan Chun on Structuring Chinese Society, the Fictions of Colonial Practice and the Changing Realities of Land in the New Territories of Hong Kong. Moving forward, I was born in Grangemouth in 1985. I moved to Glasgow when I was 4. I went to public Catholic school, I have no religion, and the schools were still at the very beginning stages of understanding race, let alone acknowledging and welcoming the idea of diversity. The racial inequality in the schools I attended provided the framework of how I would journey through life, and at a very early age, I learned that the only way to survive was to question everything. I remember being in conflict with the concept of truth, but later understood that the truth only existed in favour towards the ruling majority. And the majority is deeply ingrained and in favour of the knowledge and produced by colonial thinkers, or how history was designed by Eurocentric knowledge. And in these pictures, Grangemouth was where I was born. I lived very close to the Grangemouth oil refinery, which is quite famous because it's the biggest refinery in Scotland. And it was, at the time, considered that it was quite beautiful, the smoke and the lights, obviously not good for climate or environment. And then I moved to Glasgow Southside 4 years later. Racism can be reflected in ways that social institutions operate, by denying groups of people fair and equitable treatment, also known as institutional racism. This includes the power to establish what is normal, necessary, and desirable, and reinforces superiority or preferences for one group over another. The world is driven of temporal ruptures within where the colonial and pre-colonial past continuously interject into the present to the point that truth still doesn't exist. It's the majority of what is believed that claim what is considered truth. Throughout the centuries, colonialism, modernization, and development and globalization have been economic and political projects that carried with them into most other world cultures, the Trojan horse of the individual, destroying communal and place-based forms of relating. Now, if only Western education taught less Western idealized views of histories and encouraged a question of our relationship to land. Most people who come from immigrant families will know that to understand our history, we can't understand our history from the schools we go to, especially if it's a school that's very separate from the land that we came from. Questioning our concerns must involve eliminating how past movements and discourses go in search to answer these. So we might better situate ourselves to develop practices that can better tackle the nuances of our present time. My personal experience defined as a racial minority living in the UK, conditioned by cultural dominance, is the reason why I studied the field of design. To have some agency on my own identity and not only be dictated from my race and by mainstream media. And I'm not talking about only just popular culture, but all media. Any notion of identity or borders is still a contained box. Culture controls behavior in deep and persistent ways, many of which are outside of awareness and therefore beyond conscious control of the individual. Relating to all this knowledge that I had realized while going through my personal history, I realized the core decision of my practice was because I believed I could design other worlds. I would no longer be stereotyped or be treated like a minority. Having this treatment throughout your life dictates your every decision making. It teaches you what you don't want to be. Now that time has passed, I realize that I still have become intertwined in the Western system, and in a sense, inadvertently did the inevitable. To take ownership of my identity rather than disconnect with my heritage doesn't do justice to the history of my mother tongue or representation of my racial community. And the next task, I will ask you to state the facts of what you've learned. And it may be very different from what you would have expected. I mean, it's best not to have any expectations when you go through your family history, especially if a lot of it is quite intense and maybe has a lot of emotional baggage. But I realized my family were fighters, severely oppressed, strong and political and persistent. At a time when my family were very much, you know, focused on health and future, which are very much the main principles of Chinese culture, I also learned that knowledge of life and systems to survive corruption was very important in my upbringing. The industrialization of my heritage is still at the very beginning. My siblings and I are the first generation to have higher education, also, you know, which is also seen as third level education. My parents came to Scotland to be able to earn money to send back to their parents. They worked in the food trade in order to sustain a better life. Farmers were considered utopian, forward-thinking, being able to cultivate land to sustain a life of freedom. The people who survived through swimming across the borders risked their lives in search of freedom in the British colony. Many never made it. Some shot dead by guards, arrested and sent to labour camps. Some drowned or were attacked by sharks. Hong Kong sheltered escapees from after struggling so hard to get there, now at the present day is turning into China. History repeats itself as many Hong Kongers flee to Britain. Culture controls behaviour in deep and persisting ways, many of which are outside of awareness and therefore beyond conscious, manifest control of the individual. When challenging the deepest popular Eurocentric beliefs about ourselves as well as foreigners, it leads people to see things they might not want to see. So these things that I have realised about my practice has now made me consciously aware of how I should continue my practice, and in this way I have become deep rooted into like my history and understanding how to rethink some of my design practice in a way to also perhaps like question deeper behaviors that could be quite relevant in my work, since a lot of my work that I do now is very much about cognitive and emotional behaviors. So going into my practice, when I started working, I guess I started working originally in textiles and in fashion. These were my design intentions. My design's intentions were to create a design process which keeps the value of a universal human without referencing a specific identity such as race, gender, and shape. How to be sustainably conscious with materials whilst keeping a longevity in aesthetics and ergonomics. How to design a non-capitalist driven philosophy, questioning long-lived ideas versus short-lived ideas. To remain objective in the root of the process, to give birth to an outcome of individuality. Referencing existing work will indefinitely reiterate existing design structures, outworth my knowledge. The camera was my first medium, but not in the sense of making photography as art, but recording and dissecting my knowledge and understanding of the world. And this is a documentation from 2005, where I took a 1920s camera, which I found in the market, and instead of using it, I used it as reference to create structures in clothing. And here you see there's this octagon. I repeated the shape several times on fabric, and in this case, it created a framework to the clothing I would create later for my graduate collection. And this is very few of the works I did in textiles and tailoring, the embroidery works, tailoring and jackets, also working with embroidery, which is what I originally was my profession. I have a master's in embroidery, working with metal. And then it goes on to my design intention in 2011. So during recession, I had switched careers, a few years of figuring out what is I should do next in terms to make money and in terms to survive. In some ways, in like my parents, I still live in this context. So in 2011, my design intention was working with spatial installations, learning the presence of sound and light within our environments and physical materials, exploring the effects of cognitive emotional triggers with architectural space, experimenting with various sensory arrangements to create an emotional and psychological impact. Sonic dynamics in relation to archaeoacoustics and visceral multidimensional sense of space and vibration. And this is my work in embodied spaces. I had created a sound sculpture which was first shown in Hamburg in this beautiful space, and then I worked on a light installation in the abandoned swimming pool, and then it goes on to other derelict spaces. And below with the scenography of the stage and the costumes, that was the most recent work I did. Proxemics and body and space is important in the work I do because it also evaluates human experience and consciousness. It takes on material and spatial form and then is used as a model for understanding the creation. Creating a language about space can be a way of bridging physically distant and emotionally and ethically closed worlds, both transnationality and translocality, offer a critical approach to spatiality and the production of space. And I'll give you an example of this. This is a installation I did in Belgrade in 2017, where I tuned 11 metal tubes to the equal temperament of scale of A, where it makes up the resonance of the rotation of two moving planets. And I'm not going to reference astrology or anything really related to the planets. At the time, it was very much to do with resonance and also to create a slow, playful environment to influence psychological motives and to increase a less intellectual environment where the participants are also encouraged to listen to each other. And this is the data I used to create the instrument. I had looked at the frequencies of the rotations of Earth and used the higher order harmonics. And so here you can see the base, which is Earth, and then it talks about Venus. And now I chose Venus because it had the highest frequency value, which is also the wavelength of red and orange. And I wanted to be able to create the natural resonance of Earth, which is what humans resonate to. Supposedly it's the frequency we're born into because of Earth's rotation. And I had measured the length of these tubes based on to be able to create the frequency hertz. And in order, when people would play these, they could also encourage the higher order harmonics when played together. The frequencies are based on data readings from 1952 and 2017. The peaks of the extremely low frequency within Earth's electromagnetic field spectrum is also known as Schumann resonance. String wave calculation has shown that wave tensions exist between the center of the Earth and the Earth, which also refers to living and non-living entities existing on the surface. Resonant connection also creates tension, which is also known as gravity. In 1952, Schumann resonance was measured at 7.83 and in 2017 at 36.70. However, the higher reading could have been the higher order harmonics, although this was not scientifically proven. I was intrigued by this data and the relation to in how humans feel and transfer energy. I experimented with the higher order harmonics using 7.83 and 36.70 as fundamentals to direct the arrangement of the sounding pipes. Closely spaced frequencies will interact to produce a third frequency, which could create richer overtones when played together. Combining the measurement is a way of listening to how Earth may have sounded if we were present in both 1952 and 2017, and how bodies would interact with these vibrations, merging an alternative sense of time and space. The installation is composed of optic panels and aluminium pipes create rhythmic reflections and spatial sound resonance that distort, heighten, and shape our perception of the space. The audience interacting with the installation experience sensory tensions caused by sound, temporality, and the resonance of the environment. Exploring light in space, I have explored the basics of light techniques and history of light perception, research on how the human visual system processes information, not only focusing on logical systems, but trusting how the mind analyzes what is given. Visual process working with sound frequencies and vice versa. Sophistication versus performance and engagement. And this is an installation I had worked on. I had done a residency at the Nanophotonics Laboratory in Braga, and I worked with learning about photonics and light wave propagation. And this is a light beam through a laser going into transmitted materials, and you see how the light wave is bending. Achromology exhibits techniques of perceived color and opponent process theory, understanding colors of specific wavelengths of invisible light that can be perceived by the human eye, and how vision has the ability to sense color controlled by three receptors, complexes, and opposing actions such as red, green, blue, yellow, black, white. Both theories are needed to take account for the complexity of vision, and when put through experimentation, the space is turned into a playground, intertwining theory, process, intuitive craft, and emotional memory, with sound recordings of the machines and environment fed into the space to reinterpret the sensory process in the act of research. Here's another picture where you can see it also going through transmissive materials. And a lot of my theory work goes through this form of visual development, working out two contrasting elements such as contrast and harmony. And contrast would be instability in visual space, harmony, balance in visual space, asymmetry of forms, symmetrical forms. The interesting thing about working in this format is that you can go through tension release systems, and in terms of emotions, when you go through a tense space, whatever releases you creates a new element or a new stage of emotional recognition. Next, we will go on to attraction among objects in the visual space. The eye always seeks a simple solution, one over simplicity over complexity. The eye looks for patterns, and pattern thinking has more to offer than just the relationship between psychophysiological phenomena and visual expression, because no one unit of system can be changed without modifying the whole. And then we go into syntax systems, and I am giving examples of work by Armin Hoffman. The process of composition is the most crucial step in visual problem solving. Visual literacy, seen as a language similar to words, are combined to form phrase and sentences. The goal of many syntacticians is to discover the syntactic rules common to all languages. The syntactical potential of structure in visual literacy stem from the investigation of the process of human perception. There are no absolute rules, but there is a great deal of understanding of what will occur in terms of meaning if we make certain arrangements of the parts towards organizing and orchestrating visual means. And next task, I will ask you to compose letters. I'll give an example of composing visual literacy in phonetics if you choose to do working with the letters of phonetics, which I do encourage you to do. But in terms of international language, I will use letters. And what's interesting about this is that it doesn't matter where you come from, the vocal chambers you have in terms of how your voice uses these alphabetical letters in whatever language you're speaking, it can also create like interesting compositions, you know. Also try to keep this universal, and also, again, saying this again, not to create borders in the language we're using. Creating a set of rules and finding a potential advantage with these set of rules. So make free arrangements of these letters. Arrange these letters using each letter no less than two times and no more than three times. After you have made free compositions, use your voice to sound out your letters. This is a composition from some of my students, implementing space as rhythm. And I asked them to create a visual interpretation of these spaces within the letters. And then I asked them to perform them afterwards. They didn't perform by themselves. They composed having create phrases with a partner to be able to create a dialogue between each of them, as in like question, answer, you know, vice versa. And here's another diagram. Not all the students did a similar format. I encouraged them to have their own interpretation, and not all of them had this background in sound, and some of the ways they had processed information was quite interesting. And I'm referencing like sound and space from this diagram from Bernard Leitner, where he comes from architecture, but developed these interesting sound installations where he positioned bodies and spaces and how sound would float or reflect, refract around them in terms of their position. Like, such as using chords in space, sequence of sounds, and rhythm as space. I also encourage you to create your own diagrams as well. This can be quite fun to do because you don't really have to have a sound background, but you can maybe keep in mind of like how sounds reflect and refract and absorb. Doing this, you can also practice using your voice in your house or in your bathroom where you have tiles, which is more reflective. So you can have some fun with this, working with letters. And next up, if you choose to create sonography with your sound, you can do so in these next examples. Because a lot of the work I do with my collaborators who work in sound design, when we work together, we create these sonographies and screenplays in order to understand each other and understand the behaviors where we want to like interpret in the space. And this is one sonography that I had worked some years ago, where it talks about the emotions in the space and what the reference is, and it's including the time and how the sound would react in terms of these time limits and what would we expect to happen with human behavior. And as you can see, it says stage one, stage two, stage three, and we also gave it like a description. Ambiguous, nonchalant, digital war, chaos, and each stage has some minutes about. And normally, it would go a little bit over, a bit less, but it gives us a good framework to work with. And here's another one from a recent project where we talk about creating a world and how to inhabit space, and also how the participant would like feel in the space and shapes and repeating patterns. And here it goes more elaborate into like the stages, and these pictures are reference points. They're not necessarily the work we did, but when we start creating dialogues before the creation itself, it's very important that we give a sort of a mood board, you can call, for example, is a mood board for each stage, anyone has worked with scenography before or screenplays know that these are very important in terms of describing the series of events that would happen in the composition. And I would encourage you to have fun with this, to find your own fields of inspiration. Again, like this workshop is very much not tailored towards people with specific backgrounds, but for more to have your own language and to know there are no right or wrong ways of doing anything. I think even though I come from a design practice, I generally did study textiles where I specialized in weaving and knit. I have a master's in embroidery, and yet my knowledge of composition in terms of building instruments or working with spaces very much came from practicing in my field. You know, I didn't have any right or wrong way of doing something. I basically had an idea in mind, and I just tried to create the best way to visualize the things I was thinking about. So it's more about how you're conceptualizing the things that you're thinking about. You know, it can be, and then I think it's so important to say that it has to be your way. You know, it gives you some agency. It doesn't mean you have to take identities from other corporate fields. And by doing so, as your career extends, the years go by, you'll find you'll have your own process and you no need to look at other forms of media to be able to generate ideas that you may think is the right or wrong way. And you can check my work out here, and if you have any questions, you can also email me. Feel free to ask any questions you would like to. Thank you.